So yesterday we had seen the simplified network model, or it is also known as the simplified reference model. Okay, so a question could be asked for 8 marks on this. Then we had seen the components. Again, a question could come from 5 to 8 marks on this topic. Then the next topic that is there is architecture of a mobile telecommunication system. So again, a question could come for 8 marks on this. Okay, so all these topics are quite important. In continuing with that, the next topic is characteristics of mobile computing. So when we mean mobile computing, like I told you, the definition of mobile computing is accessing the wireless network on the move. Okay, so what are the basic characteristics of such a system? So there are 5 characteristics. Okay, we'll go one by one. Again, this is an important question for your exam. It could come from 5 to 8 marks. Okay, simple. The characteristics are quite simple. Since we already use mobiles, it's pretty easy to understand for us. Okay, so if you have any difficulty, you can let me know after I finish this topic. So the first characteristic is ubiquity. So ubiquity means the ability of a user to perform computation from anywhere and at any time. Okay, so it means, like, in other words, present everywhere. So for example, if a businessman is traveling or along the location in his car, he could receive, as long as he has access to the wireless network, he could receive notifications about his business and conduct his business transactions as long as he's having network coverage. So that is the meaning of ubiquity, the ability of the user to access the network from anywhere and at any time. Okay, the second characteristic is location awareness. So location awareness means if your mobile is having a GPS, that is your global positioning system, then the user can be tracked. Okay, and based on how the user is tracked, there are many applications. So for example, we know there are applications like Google Maps that we could use the location of the user and to find some particular destination, or we could monitor the traffic, how much traffic is there on a particular road based on the user's location. Okay, that is the meaning of location awareness. Based on the location, the application can provide some value to the user based on the GPS. The third characteristic is adaptation. So by adaptation, we mean it should have the ability to adjust to the bandwidth fluctuations. Okay, and while adjusting to the bandwidth fluctuation, it should not inconvenience the user. So as you know, in your mobile is not connected by a fixed wire. Okay, so the bandwidth is not constant. Depending on the coverage, the bandwidth fluctuates. If you are closer to the tower, you get more bandwidth and a better signal. If you are further away, you get a weaker signal. So normally this thing should happen, the fluctuation should happen without the user coming to know. Okay, but that is the meaning of this characteristic, adaptation. Okay, because like you know, there are a lot of obstacles in the environment, or there's noise and all this, due to which the bandwidth fluctuates. So ability to adjust to that is very important. And the fourth characteristic is broadcast. So your system should have a method or mechanism to efficiently deliver data simultaneously to hundreds of users. Okay, so that is broadcasting. And the last characteristic is personalization. So services can be easily personalized according to a user's profile. So each user can personalize the services according to his or her needs. Okay, so for example, like you know, in your mobiles you install apps according to your likes and dislikes. Also, whatever the default settings, you can change. So that is the meaning of personalization. So all the services in your mobile environment can be changed according to your likes and dislikes. So basically, these are the five characteristics of mobile computing. Very important question. Okay. So just to remind you, first one is ubiquity. Second one is location awareness. Third one is adaptation. Okay. Ubiquity means from anywhere, anytime. Location awareness means based on GPS giving some service to the user. Adaptation means adjusting to the bandwidth. Fourth one is broadcast, means ability to deliver data simultaneously to many users. And personalization means you can change the services in your mobile according to your profile, your likes and dislikes. Okay, so these are the five characteristics of a mobile computing. So if you have any questions, you can let me know, or we can proceed to the next topic. Okay, by the way, I just wanted to show you here, all those who are present online. See, I can mark your attendance is getting marked automatically. Okay, so you can see here the people who have come. I get all the timings here, those who have logged in, logged off. Okay, so all the people in green here, you can see, are the ones who are present. Okay, you can see there are various there are bars here which are showing what time the person has come, not come, entered. So please note that you all are getting recorded. It's not like I have to physically call out your numbers. So there are right now 34 people, and it's all showing me here, all the people who are present. Okay. So okay, there are no questions. So I think I'll proceed. So the next topic that we look at is the structure of a mobile computing application. Like last time I had told you the different layers, there were five layers. Now in the application layer, how will the mobile computing application look like? Okay, what are the main layers involved with a mobile computing application? Okay, the main layers involved in that application okay, now I will explain you this with the help of two figures. Okay, like it is mentioned here, these figures are taken from your textbook, so this figure numbers are put for your reference. Okay, now in exams, please don't put it like this. Sometimes I see the students write it like this, as shown in figures 2.3 and 2.4. you can relabel this figures as figure 1 and figure 2 and write here. Okay, so I'm telling you this because although you are final year students, in the past I've seen it, you'll just blindly write what is there in the book or what is there in the slide. Okay. So basically your mobile computing application is made up of these three layers. So at the topmost we are having a presentation layer. Okay, below that is the application layer, and then we are having the data layer. Okay, there are other layers which are involved, but those are not being shown here. Okay, so basically they are just explaining you the structure of your application in terms of these three layers. Okay, so with the help of an example, in the next figure I'll show you how these layers work and what is the functionality of these layers with regards to your application. Okay, so in the next figure, again it's the same three tiers are shown: presentation tier, application tier, and data tier. Tier 1, tier 2, and tier 3. Okay, the same three tiers are shown. So this we'll understand with the help of this example how basically your application works at different layers. So basically the topmost layer of your mobile computing application is your presentation tier. Okay, and it basically deals with the user interface. Okay, a good user interface allows the users to issue requests. Okay, so basically you can see here the user is asking a request to find a sales total. You can ask or ask for a request your query. You can put your query here. Okay, now this query obviously runs on the client's side, So on the client's computer or on the client's mobile. Okay, this query runs on the client's side, and normally it is this query is fired to a web browser or some customized client program. Okay, so basically the presentation tier is used for collecting the data or the query from the user. Okay, so now this query goes to the application tier. So this application tier is now responsible for making logical decisions. Okay, and it may perform calculations based on those logical decisions. Okay, so it is also responsible for moving the data from the presentation tier, whatever the query was fired, to the data tier. Okay, or it is responsible for moving the result from the data tier back to the presentation tier. So application tier acts as the you can say as a middle tier, and it connects the presentation tier to the data tier. Okay, so the application tier basically does the processing of the user input. It obtains the information, okay, from the data tier, and then presents the makes some decisions and then forwards those data to the back to the presentation tier. So application tier is made up of technology like it can be implemented with Java, .NET, etc. Okay, and normally it is implemented on the server side. Okay, the application tier is normally implemented on the server side. So you have to remember it is used to make some decisions. Make some logical decisions and forward that query to the data tier. So from the database now here, okay, the result is obtained. So basically the data tier is responsible for data storage, access of this data, and manipulating the data. Okay, so you can store and retrieve the data from this database. So this data tier is also implemented on the server side. Okay, so just to explain you this example how it works, you present the data here, your query whatever is here, so you forward it to the application tier. Okay, so the application tier makes a logical decision what is the query and forwards it to the database. From the database the result is obtained, okay, and it is sent back to the application tier. So this is the result. Once the application tier gets the result, it presents it to the presentation layer. So basically, suppose the query was to find the sales total, so the query is made, find the list of the sales made in last year, the result is obtained here, and from the storage it is sent here, these are the sales, there were 5 sales. So it makes a sum of all the sales of the 5 sales, and then it presents the answer here. Okay, so that is the way it works. So presentation tier is implemented on client side. Okay, and application tier is and data tier is on the server side. Okay. So when you are asked to explain the structure of a mobile computing application, basically you have to draw both these figures, this figure along with the next figure, and explain this diagram. Okay, explain this diagram with just now what I just mentioned with all those things. Okay, so any questions about this? Any questions about the structure of a mobile computing application? So you can just go through these points. Okay, this is what I have already explained. You can just read it through. Okay, so this is basically the structure of a mobile computing application. Okay, so these are all part of yesterday's slide. So I've already uploaded this slide onto the classroom. So this is already present with you all if you all have accessed it. Okay, so starting with a new topic today. Okay, now basically in our subject, okay, one of the things that we are going to do over the next 2-3 units is we are going to check the various layers, okay, and some protocols of those layers. Like mostly we are going to check the data link layer, the transport layer, and the IP layer. Okay, we are going to check whether the protocols of the fixed networks. By fixed network we mean the wired networks. Your LAN, which is connected to with the help of a broadband or some cable, okay, whether those same protocols can be used in wireless communication. Okay, if they can be used or they cannot be used. If they cannot be used, why they cannot be used. Okay, so we are just going to do a basic study of all these protocols. Okay, we're not going to go deep into these protocols, into the working of these protocols. So it is assumed that you know these protocols. You have already studied them in two subjects in CNN, data communication. So it is understood that you know these protocols. So we are not going to go deep into the working. We are just going to check whether the same protocols can be used for wireless communication. If not, then why? And then what can be done to solve the problem if there are any problems? Okay. So with regards to that, we are starting with the first layer, that is our data link layer. Okay, so as you know, MAC is a part. Okay, MAC is a part of your data link layer. What is MAC? Medium access control. Okay, so MAC is a part of your data link layer, and we are going to start with this, whether the same protocols that are there in MAC can be used in MAC protocols that are used in wired systems can be used in wireless systems. Okay, what are some of the protocols that you have studied? Just to remind you, FDMA, TDMA, CDMA, Aloha. Okay, all these algorithms that you have studied are part of your MAC. Okay, or your data link layer. So basically, we are going to see whether those existing protocols can be used here. Okay. If not, then why? So let's start with this. So first of all, you need to know what is the meaning of a protocol. Okay, so protocol means it's some standard way of accessing a medium or a standard way of exchanging the data over a medium. Okay, you should know how the data is to be formatted, how it is to be sent, how it is to be received, how to check for errors in the data, whether the data should be compressed. Okay, so the standard set of rules, protocol means a standard set of rules for exchanging data over some network. Okay, that is the meaning of a protocol. So why do we need some protocol in a wireless network? So because we are using our medium for communication in a wireless network is air. So basically we are transmitting our waves or data over the air. And since more than one mobile is going to be used, now most of the times we'll be using this term node. Okay. So since more than one node is using the medium and is sharing the medium, that's why we need a protocol. We need some disciplined way of accessing the shared resources. Okay, so in our case, the shared resource is the channel. Channel is the air through which the radio wave is transmitted or your electromagnetic wave is transmitted. Okay, so what is the medium access control? Okay, so like I told you, it works at the data link layer. Okay, and then it has some rules for accessing the shared medium. So it works by invoking the physical layer, and the main responsibility of the Mac is to maintaining the discipline in accessing the shared medium. There are some rules. It's like a traffic policeman is there on your roads at a junction to handle the traffic, so there's not a big mess at the junction and everyone is confused. So the same way, it's the job of the Mac in networking to decide how all the mobile nodes or all the systems involved in the transmission access the shared medium. Okay, so there are some properties of Mac. Okay, important properties of Mac, we'll go through them one by one. So like this is a question that some of you may be thinking, are all the Mac protocols having the same rules? And the answer is no. Okay, they don't have the same properties, they don't have the same rules, but they work in a similar manner. Okay, that is to control the access to the shared medium. So like, you know, you have already studied so many algorithms, FDMA, TDMA, CDMA, Aloha, slotted Aloha. Okay, so you know all these algorithms work in a different way, but their job is the same, to send the data from the sender to the receiver. So they do the transmission in different ways, but they don't work in exactly the same. They are not the same. So now there are around five properties of Mac. So these are the five main properties of Mac. Okay, the first main property, first of those properties is, it should implement some rules that enforce discipline when multiple nodes are have to send data over the same shared channel. Okay, so basically it should have some rules to decide who sends the data at what time slot, or how some priority or some rules should be well defined to decide who sends the data at what time. Okay, so besides that, it should also help to maximize the utilization of the channel. Okay, so when it implements the first rule, it does not mean that if the bandwidth of the channel is say 100, it just utilizes 10% of that bandwidth. So then it's a waste. So it should help to utilize the maximum possible bandwidth of the channel. Okay. Third point is, it should be, the Mac protocol should be fair. So all the allocation needs to be fair. No node should be discriminated against at any time and made to wait for a long time for transmission. Just because one particular node may be having a higher priority, it does not mean that only that node can transmit at all the time. All the nodes should be given a equal chance, you can say, or depending on the way the algorithm has been developed. Fourth property is, it should be capable of supporting several types of traffic. Okay. So for example, some nodes may have different transmission rates. Some nodes may be fast, some nodes may be slower. So it should be able to support the different speeds of the various nodes. It should not be able, if it cannot handle the different speeds, then there will be a loss of data. Okay. And the fifth important point is, it should be a robust. The protocol should be robust. So in case equipment fails, or the network conditions change, then it should not happen that the transmission stops. So basically, these are the five main points with regards to the properties required for Mac protocols. The first property is enforce some rules. Second is maximize the utilization of the channel. The third is it should be fair. Okay, just try to remember this. First one is discipline, second is utilization, third is fair, fourth is support maximum traffic, okay, or different types of traffic, and fifth is robust. In case the network fails, then still somehow it should be able to handle the some equipment fails or the network conditions change, it should still manage to do the transmission. So one of the important MAC protocols that we have standardized till now for wireless network is this one, IEEE 802.11. so basically it deals with the Wi-Fi. So you know, we have already, we use this for our hotspots whenever you set up Wi-Fi hotspots and all. Okay, so still there is work which is going on to improve its efficiency. Okay, so this is the standard protocol that we use these days for our wireless communication. So this is the MAC protocol that we are using for wireless network. Okay, so this IEEE 802.11 contains all these MAC protocols. Okay, that are used for communication. So does anyone have any questions with regards to the properties or what is the meaning of a protocol? Am I going fast? You can just let me know. Am I fast? Is it okay? The speed is okay. Okay, speed is okay. Okay. So I hope you all have understood. Okay. If you all have any questions, then you can always ask me when we meet for offline class also. Okay. Okay, so basically these are the properties of MAC. Now remember that in wireless communication, okay, in wireless communication there is no fixed medium, meaning the medium is air. Okay, so by fixed I mean there is no wire connecting the two mobiles. Okay, you just send your waves in the air. So as the waves are traveling in the air, there are various obstacles. There are mountains, there are buildings, there are vehicles, there are people. Okay, then the waves cannot travel in a straight line because there are so many natural obstacles. Okay, so in spite of this, the communication has to happen. Okay, so implementing a protocol in wired networks is easier because they don't have to face these issues. They have to deal with other kind of issues like errors in the data or some other kind of errors. Okay, they don't have to worry whether about such obstacles. Whereas in wireless communication, whenever you are designing some algorithms, you have to worry about such kind of problems like range of the mobile. If the mobile is out of the tower's range, it may not reach receive only the communication. Okay. So all these factors, additional factors, need to be considered while designing a protocol for wireless networks. Okay, so as such, in general, we cannot use the same protocol of wired networks for wireless networks. Okay, like I showed you in yesterday's PPT. Okay, let me just open that PPT. This diagram here. So as a mobile, suppose a mobile is present here, okay, and as the mobile is moving across this, like this, suppose it reaches here, there was one base station here. Okay, so let's call it as base station 1. There was base station 2 here. There was a base station 3 here. So like I told you, base station is nothing but a mobile tower. So first it was connected to this base station 1. Okay, as it moves over the edge here, the boundary of the cell, the MSC, the switching center, has to switch this mobile to the second tower as it enters this. Okay, so as this handover, this is known as handover, you are switching from one tower to the next tower. So when you are doing this handover, okay, remember this term, handover. When the handover is happening, that is the mobile is moving from one cell to the other cell, again there may be a loss of data if it is not done properly. Okay, so there are all such kind of issues that have to be taken care of while designing the protocols for wireless networks. Okay, so there are many more issues in wireless networks compared to wired networks, and plus all those errors are there only with all those issues which are there in wired networks are there only present in wired networks. So let's discuss two of the most common issues. Okay, I think we have enough time. Your lecture ends at 10:15. Okay, and these are very important issues with regards to your this unit at least. Okay, so rest of the algorithms and all we'll be discussing with these two, with respect to these two issues. Okay, so I'll explain both, at least one of them. If you have any doubts, you can let me know. It's pretty simple. Okay, so let's look at these issues in the MAC protocol in wireless networks. Okay, so there are two main issues. One is known as the hidden terminal problem, and the second one is known as the exposed terminal problem. Okay, hidden terminal, exposed terminal. Okay, so like I told you, in wireless medium, implementing the MAC protocol is difficult. Okay, one of the reasons is detecting collisions is quite difficult. Okay, in wired networks it's easier, in wireless networks is tougher. Okay, so with regards to this issues in there are two main issues: hidden terminal problem and exposed terminal problem. Okay, so let's go through them one by one. So the first one, I will explain you the hidden terminal problem. Okay, let me just correct this. This circle, no, is like this. Okay, just to, it is on your textbook. I'll share the diagram later. You can take a picture from your textbook. Okay, so just remember this circle is like this. Okay, it gets hidden in this diagram. Okay, okay. So what is shown here is three mobile nodes are shown. Okay, A, B, and C. Okay, so there are at least three mobile nodes have to be present for a hidden terminal problem to occur. Okay, now pay attention. Okay, this circle means the range of this node. Okay, this is your mobile, and this circle means this is the range of the node A. Okay, similarly this other circle that is shown is the range of the node C. Okay, now you can see this node B is falling within the circle of A, that is the range of A. Also it falls within the range of C, that is within the circle of C. So B falls in the range of A, also falls in the range of C. And you can, okay, so let me just tell you this, you can note it down also if you want. Okay, the node A is in the range of, the node A is in the range of node B, and B also is in the range of node C. Okay, but A and C are not within each other's range. Okay, A and C are not within each other's range. Now, what is the hidden terminal problem? Okay, suppose first I tell you what is how the communication works without a problem. Okay, suppose A is transmitting a data to B. then this communication could occur without any problem. Okay. Similarly, if C is transmitting data to B, only this communication is happening. C is sending data to B, then this also happens without any problem. Okay. C is transmitting data to B. But the problem occurs when A and C, okay, node A and C, both decide to send data at the same time to B. Now, what is the problem? Okay. A, your node A, does not know that this C exists. Okay. A does not know that C exists because within the range of A, this is the range of A. This is the range of A. Okay. This is the range of A. So within the range of A, only B is present. Okay. Only B is present. So it is not aware that C is present. Okay. Similarly, C is not aware that A is present because within the range of, this is the range of C, right? This is the range of C. So within the range of C, only B is present. A, it is not aware of that A is present. Okay. So now both of these decide to send data at the same time. Okay. They want to send data. So A wants to send data to B. And at the same time, C wants to send data to B. Now what C thinks, within the range of C, only B is there. So if it sends the data, there is no problem because it is not aware that A is there. Similarly, A thinks within its range only B is there. So if it sends data, there is no problem since it is not aware that C is there. So if both send data at the same time, okay, then a collision occurs here. That problem is known as the hidden terminal problem. Understood? Okay. Okay. Did you all get it? I can repeat it again if you all want. Did you all understand what is the hidden terminal problem? You can just let me know if you all understood. Got it? Aditya, Akash, Elston, understood? Okay, I'll repeat it. Okay, you can sit with a book and just note down it what I'm mentioning. Okay, so basically, okay, I'll tell you when the problem does not occur. Okay, I'll tell you when the problem does not occur. See, within the range of A, there is only one more node. Within the range of A, only one more node is there, which is B. Okay, so if A is sending data to B, only one station is transmitting, then there's no problem. Okay, this communication will happen without collision. Okay, there will be no collision only if this transmission is happening. Okay, similarly, the second example which will work fine without collision is, say, C is transmitting data. Okay, A is not transmitting now. Okay, A is not transmitting. C is transmitting now. Okay, so within the range of C, this is the range of C. Okay, so within the range of C, this is the entire range of C, this circle. Okay, so within the range of C, only B is present. Okay, so now C is transmitting the data to B. A is not transmitting, only C is transmitting one station at a time. Okay, then this also transmission works fine, this is also fine, no problem. Okay, no collision occurs. Okay, no collision. So understood both the cases when no collision occurs. When the problem occurs is, let me just rub off this thing. The problem occurs when both A and C decide to transmit the data at the same time. Okay. See, now this is the circle of C. Okay, so within the radio range of A, within the radio range of A, B is present. Okay, who is not present? C is not present. Okay, similarly, within the radio range of C, who is present? B is present. Who is not present? A is not present. Okay, C is not aware that A is present because this is the range of C. Okay, this is the range of C. So C is not aware that A is there. Similarly, since this is the range of A, A is not aware that C is present. Okay, so if A decides, if A decides to transmit data, and simultaneously at the same time C decides to transmit data to B, both of them are sending data to B at the same time. Since they are not aware, A and C are not aware of each other's existence, since they are sending data at the same time to B, what will happen here? B is receiving data from two sources at the same time, so there will be a collision. Okay, and this problem is known as the hidden terminal problem. Did you get it? Are you getting? So this problem occurs because A is not aware of C's existence and C is not aware of A's existence. So assuming A assumes that it can safely transmit the data to B since no other station is present within that range. Since it assumes that it can transmit the data safely, it sends. Okay. Simultaneously, at the same time, C also assumes that there is no other station within the range of B. So it also sends the data at the same time. So when both of them are sending data at the same time, what is happening? There is a collision at this node. Okay. And that problem is known as the hidden terminal problem. Is it okay? Yes, got it, everyone? Okay. So it's a very important question, okay? What are the issues with relation to MAC? Or they could just ask you independently with the help of a diagram, explain the hidden terminal problem. They could just give you, they may not give you the, they could give you this question directly, explain the hidden terminal problem, or they may draw more circles, they may include more nodes, okay, and then ask you whether there's a hidden terminal problem in that. It could be just your application. So for example, you may include some more circles like this, include some more nodes. Okay, and then ask you, if D wants to send data to A, is there a hidden terminal problem? Then you have to apply the logic and check. Okay, such questions also could be asked for you for exam. So first you need to understand based on this diagram. One, it's pretty simple if you have understood on this diagram. Okay, so for your exam, first of all, when you're writing this answer, it could come for 8 marks by itself, this question. Explain hidden terminal problem. So first you have to start by telling, okay, that there should be at least 3 nodes present, okay, as shown in the figure, to communicate with each other, okay, or among each other. Then you have to explain that A is in the range of node B but not in the range of node C. Then you have to tell node C is the range of, is in the range of node B but not in the range of node A. Then you have to write node B is in the range of both node A and node C. You have to explain all this. Okay. Then if you want, that is not compulsory to explain. You can explain the 2 situations when the data will transmit correctly, but you need not explain that. Okay. You can directly explain when the problem occurs. So you can tell when A and C transmit simultaneously. Okay. The data received at B will be garbled, or there will be a collision that occurs here. Okay, why the collision occurs, you have to write, because A is hidden from C. Okay, A is not aware of C, so there will be a collision. Or A and C are both hidden from each other, therefore there will be a collision. Because they are outside each other's transmission range. Okay. So this is your hidden terminal problem. So you can just read this. I have explained exactly the same thing. Okay, let's go to the next problem, exposed terminal problem. Okay, exposed terminal problem. So again, let me complete this diagram. Some circles have got hidden. So this circle should come so basically this is the circle. Okay, now it should be a circle like. Okay, so this is the way your diagram will look actually. Okay, in your textbooks, if you refer to the textbook. Okay, this is a circle, just remember. So again, what is the problem here? Okay, so normally a MAC protocol does not allow the transmission. Okay, when suppose there are two nodes within the range of each other, then allows only, say there are three nodes within each other's range, it allows only two nodes to transmit data at a time. Okay, so if there are three nodes within each other's range, then it does not allow simultaneous communication between all the nodes. Okay, it allows only any two nodes to transmit at a time. Okay, this is to prevent collision. Okay, if they are within each other's range. Now, so first let's understand who is within each other's range. Okay, you can note it down also, draw this diagram quickly if you want. Okay, now as you can see here, this is the purple thing is the transmission range of A. Okay, the purple circle is the transmission range of A. So D is within the transmission range of A. Okay, D is in the within the transmission range of A. Okay, one more circle I forgot to complete. I'll just complete that. This red circle is the okay. So. Next is node B. As you can see, node B is within the transmission range of A and C. Okay, you can see B, the A's transmission circle purple is touching B, also C's circle is touching B. So B is within the range of A and C, but you can see A is not in the range of C. Okay, C's circle is this black one, so A is not in the range of C. Similarly, C is not in the range of A. Clear? So again, I'll repeat this, please note down. D is in the range of A. It is already inside the circle of purple circle. So D is in the range of A. Okay. B is within A's and C's transmission range because it is part of their circles. You can see the part of the purple circle. Also, it is part of the black circle. So B is in the range of A and C. A is not in the range of C. Purple circle ends here, does not touch C. Similarly, C's black circle ends here, does not touch A. So A and C are not in the range of each other. Okay. Now, what is the rule that I told you? you can write down this rule. MAC protocols do not allow transmission, okay, when transmission from another terminal is detected. MAC protocols do not allow transmission when transmission from another terminal is detected. Okay. So, what is the problem that occurs? Okay, there's one problem that occurs here is, suppose, okay, C is transmitting data to B. C is transmitting data to B. Okay, let me tell you like this. Say we had a situation where C wanted to send data to B. C wanted to send data to B. Okay. And say A wanted to send data to D. Now we want to do these two transmissions. Okay. I want to send data from node C to B. I want to send data from A to D. Okay. Now let's see whether this can happen. So let me just change this color. So when C is sending data here to B, okay, C starts with the transfer first. Let's assume C starts with the transfer here. Okay. So when C is sending data to B, okay, what will happen? This transmission will happen smoothly because there is no other node that is transmitting data within the range of C. Okay. Within the range of C. Now, when this transmission is happening, MAC does not allow your MAC protocol does not allow any other node within the range of C, within the range of C, or within the range of B to transmit data. Since this transmission is already happening, I'm repeating again, okay, please note down. Since this transmission is already happening, MAC protocol or the MAC does not allow transmission to happen from any node which is in the range of C or from the range of B. Now within the range of C, there is only one more node which is B. Okay. But within the range of B, the red circle is B. Okay. Within the range of B, there is node C and there is node A. So since these two parties are involved in transmission, there's no problem here. But what it will MAC do? It will not allow A to start with any transmission. Where A wanted to send the data, A wanted to send the data to D. A wanted to send the data to D. But since A is in the range of B, since A is in the range of B, A will not be allowed to send data here. A will not be allowed to send data here. Okay. Now, so what is the problem? The problem is if A was allowed to send data here to D, this transmission here is not interfering with this transmission here. Okay. These two transmissions would happen independently of each other. Okay. They're not interfering with each other, but because of that MAC rule, what is the MAC rule? MAC says if two nodes are transmitting, no other node within the range of those two nodes can start transmission. So since A falls in the range of B, it is not allowed to start the transmission. Okay. But whereas if this transmission was allowed, this data transfer between A to D would not interfere with the transmission from C to B. Okay. So this kind of a problem is known as the exposed terminal problem. Okay. This is known as the exposed terminal problem. So why we call it an exposed? This terminal A is exposed to the transmission between or exposed to the terminal B, and B is involved in the transmission here. So since A is exposed to this terminal B, A is not allowed to start the transmission. So if A was allowed, so it causes unnecessary bandwidth wastage, because this transmission, it causes a delay also. There's a wastage of time. This transmission could have occurred without causing any errors in this transmission between C to B. So since we are not allowing this transmission, this is one of the problems in MAC. Okay, did you get it? Hopefully. If any questions, you can ask me. Did you all get it? Did you all understand exposed terminals? Yes, students, can you give me some feedback? Got it, everyone? Okay. So these are two important problems. There are two, three different types of questions that could be asked. Okay, one question could be based on this. One question could be, okay, let me just rub off all this thing. Okay. So I'll share this. Okay, just one more, note down one thing. In this slide, by mistake, after this exposed terminal, again this thing is come as hidden terminal. Okay, so remember on this last slide, this is the explanation for exposed terminal. Okay, just remember when I share this PPT, this thing will be dealing with the last slide. After this diagram is explanation for exposed. Okay, just remember this is come wrongly. Okay, let me stop the recording, because then the recording becomes too big.